Welcome to this week's episode of Two Guys and Some Horror. I'm hanging with the boys trying to impress the ladies while Clark's hallucinating a metalhead rocker we like to call the Driller Killer because we watch Sleepaway Camp and Slumber Party Massacre 2.
How's it going, everybody?
What's up? Welcome to the show.
Yeah, that Driller Killer, he can drill me anytime. All right.
So the first movie we're going to talk about is Sleepaway Camp from 1983. Its runtime is 88 minutes, and it's got a Rotten Tomato score of 82%. The synopsis for the film is, Bunks and the Showers are a mad stabber's beat at a summer camp strictly for teens.
So this movie starts off with some of the worst written dialogue I've heard in a long time. It felt like it was written by somebody who grew up in the 1950s or the 1960s. So this guy and this gal are on a boat, and this girl's like, oh, don't be such a square. Let me drive the boat. And so this kid lets her drive the boat, and she runs over a couple people. And this kid in the background screams, he's like, somebody help them! Somebody help them! And that's how the movie begins.
Oh, come on. You skipped, like, one of my favorite parts of this movie.
What did I skip?
The dramatic opening of the scenes of a campgrounds and the flashback to every single kill throughout the film.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so the opening credits, and I'm not giving this movie any credit. I love Sleepaway Camp. I think if, as the viewers listen, or as the listeners listen, they'll hear a different perspective, which is awesome. This is probably the first time I feel like Clark and I aren't 100% on boat. Get it? On boat. With the same exact opinion of a film. And that's exactly what we're here to do. We're just here to talk and give our opinions on these different movies that we watch. So I picked the films that we watched this week, Sleepaway Camp and Slumber Party Massacre 2. I love Sleepaway Camp. I've watched it way too many times. And the first, you know, dude, it feels like forever, 5 minutes in that movie is opening credits. So it's slow music. It's almost like if you were watching a Broadway play, how they kind of have the open song that also then goes into the closing part of the show. It's very similar. They take you through the entire movie, kill by kill. You get to hear the characters actually talking. The same exact quotes and whatnot are used in this open as they happen in the scene as well. So you get a lot of foreshadowing about these characters. You can hear Ricky cursing at the top of his lungs. You get to hear some of Mel, I believe, actually talking as well. So for me, like, the open is very dramatic and foreshadows a lot in the film if you're paying attention and you catch on to it. But yes, you're right. The boat scene dialogue, that's the true open to the film. That's the first characters you get to see and the first real dialogue we get to listen to. And it is abysmal.
I gotta tell you, I don't remember the that intro. I don't remember it at all. So I don't know why I didn't see that.
I watched it on Amazon. Did you watch?
I did. Yeah. So it's interesting that I missed that because the only thing I remember from the beginning is the screaming. So maybe I completely blocked all of that out.
Probably for good reasons. Yeah. You were not a fan of this movie, that is for sure.
I'm not a fan. I'm just not a fan. But we can talk more about that.
Let's keep going. So the girl argues with the boyfriend. Let me drive the boat. I believe she even makes a comment. Oh, my dad's got one bigger than this.
Yeah, I thought it was a dick joke.
I thought it was a dick joke for sure. So what happens with the boat?
The boat runs over this family of three, or this adult with his two kids, and you see the boat kind of fly above them. I actually have the Sleepaway Camp intro going on right now while we're doing this.
Nice.
And just... I'm not seeing kills.
No, you don't. Sorry, you don't see any kills. You hear it. So as the intro is playing, the audio, you get the music, and then you kind of get subtle audio tidbits as the music kind of, it'll peak a little bit in the intro, and then you can kind of hear the characters, and then it goes back down a little bit.
Right, I see what you're talking about. Yeah. So there's some, like, some of the baseball game, the softball
yeah,
game.
Yeah, yeah,
potentially.
Oh,
yeah. Potentially.
Oh, my God. I can't wait till we get to the baseball game. It's my favorite quote in the movie. Okay, so the mom – so all that happens. The boat whacks the dad. You actually see nothing, realistically. You see, like, a hand on the boat that they were on that they flipped over thinking it was funny. The little kid, the kids, the girl and the boy. And then the boat smashes into that boat and kills the dad. We know for sure the dad's dead. And as his body's kind of, to me, yeah. He just sprung out and kind of laid out across the water, you know? And then we see a life jacket. Skier.
And the water skier just yells out, "Somebody help them! Oh my God!"
Oh man, she's so annoying.
The most overacting, like in terms of overacting, she takes the cake in this film. Nobody overacted quite as well as she did. So 10 out of 10. Good work.
You don't even give Ricky overacting skill? Like, you don't give Ricky that credit?
No, Ricky did his best, but that girl, she definitely wins. 10 out of 10. Gets my award for this movie.
All right. I like it.
Yeah.
So we go through, the life jacket comes up, it's a bloody ripped up mess, and one of the kids dies.
Yeah.
And we find out later that it was the sister. The sister's dead. Wait, is that right?
What's that?
No, so John dies, and then you don't actually see which kid's dead.
We don't even, like, I... From the scene, it's kind of hard to determine who dies.
Right, because, like, they don't show... That's right, yeah.
For a first-time viewer, like, you kind of just think, okay, so people just died at this camp. And it kind of moves into the next scene where this crazy lady, like, calls kids down.
Yeah, it goes right to the mom. That's right. Yeah.
You could just tell there's something not mentally right with her, because she's like... Calm down, my dears. It's kind of like a 1940s Leave It to Beaver mother character. And she's like, "Oh, you're going to be late." And then she puts her finger on her face and she goes, "No, that won't do."
Yeah, I can't tell if she's just a bad actress or it's a combination of bad acting and bad character portrayal. You know, they want her to seem kind of kooky and weird.
I think they definitely portray her as crazy, but... it's not an Oscar-winning performance by any means, but she does a good job of kind of showcasing that she's a little loopy, and it's believable.
Yeah, my first note on her is, this mom is ridiculous.
Yeah. So, anyhow, they get on a bus, and they go to camp, and that's
why... One note before the camp, before they head. She's forgotten something, Clark. Do you remember what she forgot? The most important. Yeah, she tied a string around her finger to remind herself, because, you know, you gotta always remember things. You don't ever want to forget things.
I don't remember.
She forgot that they needed a physical for camp.
Oh, they needed a physical for camp?
What camp have I ever? So I've been to quite a few camps. Okay, I've been to a church camp and a few different sports camps, and I've never needed a physical, even for the sports ones. So. I don't know if it's a sign of the times or what, but it feels very weird that these kids had to bring a physical. And then she tells the kids, "Don't tell anyone how you got these physicals." That's pretty weird.
Okay, so I don't even remember that part, but that's relatively important. If this is your first time watching this movie, or if you haven't seen it before, that would kind of stand out.
It should help you. Yeah, it should definitely help you along the way.
I tend to, when I was watching it, I was like, oh, okay. Didn't really think anything of it. And I guess from a second time view, like, things would make a bit more sense. But from a first time viewer, you're just kind of coming in. You're like, I don't understand how these scenes are going to connect to one another.
Yeah, I remember my first time watching this. And I had no idea what was going on, honestly. The whole time through, I thought I knew. I thought I was on point. I thought I understood who the killer was. And, you know, and you go, time goes by, you think everything's fine. And then when you get to the end of this movie, it is such a payoff. And I'm really trying not to, we don't want to spoil things. We try to avoid spoiling things. So if you are worried that this might spoil anything for you. I promise you, we're not going to tell you what's nothing going on at the end. Spoiling. Nothing massive.
Specifically for this film.
But if you are worried, please stop the podcast now. Go give this movie a watch and come back and finish listening with us after that. Because
there will be spoilers.
Just there's going to be some things. Yeah.
Not the major thing.
Correct. So we get to camp, and my favorite character enters the film. Ricky's best friend, Paul. The dude is probably one of the most underrated actors in this film. So Paul, the best friend, he's the one who ends up dating, I guess, Angela for the majority of the film. He's just a solid kid actor. Like, he doesn't do a bad job. He doesn't do a great job, but he does a good job. Like, he delivers his lines appropriately, and I feel like he's probably one of the more underrated actors in this movie. He's not overacting by any means.
He's the Casanova of the film.
Yeah, I think so. I think he does a pretty good job. And he mentions to Ricky that Judy got big over the summer. And Judy's Ricky's...
She grew some boobos.
She grew some boobies. And they're all excited about that. Ricky dated... Was it dated? Yeah, he dated dated Judy the previous summer at camp. They were an item.
Not this camp. Now she's turned into a massive bitch, and just completely an asshole to him and everyone else, especially Angela. She hates Angela because Angela is popular with a couple guys, and she doesn't like that at all. So, yeah.
I'm not sure it's so much even jealousy. It's definitely a little bit of jealousy, but it's more like I think Judy feels that Angela doesn't deserve the attention she's getting because she doesn't do anything. She doesn't talk. She doesn't say a single word. Angela doesn't say a single word in this film until...
She just stares at her.
Yeah, until way later.
She's just staring at her like a serial killer. And Judy's like, do you do anything? And also the counselor that's in charge of their cabin or their bunk is just a complete ass to Angela as well. And they both kind of like conspire against her. And
Meg.
The whole film. Yeah, Meg. And you have like, so from all the films we've seen previously, like there's been like a running theme of all the people being completely shitty. In this film, there's actually a handful of good people. Which I appreciate. Yeah. But then there's some really fucked up individual.
There's, so next big moment in the film. Oh, sorry. Before we skip this, I got a comment here. Ronnie is fucking jacked.
Oh, dude. No, Ronnie he's the hero of the movie. Let's just be honest. He doesn't die. I'm spoiling. Ronnie doesn't die, and he doesn't need to die. He's a fantastic character. He's kind. He's like the voice of reason. Yeah. Ronnie's just, he's the star of the film. I'm going to say that.
I agree.
Ronnie gets my fresh eggplant of the award of the film. I just made that up, but he gets it.
I got a comment about Ronnie for later in the movie as well that we'll get back to. But so after we meet kind of Ronnie and Mel and Meg, some of these are counselors, some of them are camp goers, different people that you're going to meet. But you meet the crew. Like the sick chef, Artie, and then Ben, his sidekick who helps him in the cafeteria or in the kitchen.
Ben's the token black guy who talks like a 1950s caricature.
Yeah, I wouldn't call
it. Oh, master. Oh, yes. Golly gee whiz. I sure love to cook.
Is that jive talk? Is that considered jive talk?
He doesn't do jive, but it's pretty close.
I was going to say, they almost had him portraying like a 10 or 20 year older African-American in this film versus what I would feel like he would have been in the 80s, but definitely like not a great portrayal.
I'm telling you, man, the script was written by somebody who did not understand the 80s or even the 70s for that matter. It had a script similar to, I wouldn't even put it on par with the Brady Bunch. I would say it's even more dated than that. The Brady Bunch came out. It didn't start in like the late 60s and like the 70s. So like it was definitely written by somebody who wasn't up to date on how modern society worked in the 1980s.
His name, actor name, just kind of interesting. I was just looking at, I keep my eye on the IMDb throughout the entire episode, but his name is Robert Earl Jones.
Okay.
Which makes me think of, is it James Earl Jones who does the voice of, is that Vader in Star Wars?
James Earl Jones did do Darth Vader. He was also Mufasa.
Yeah.
So I'm looking it up here. Jones. He's the father of James Earl Jones.
No way.
Yep.
Wow. That's
James Earl Jones' dad, who's only in like the two scenes, and then he's just not in the film for the rest of the movie.
Basically. But
moving along, like the Angela's not eating, so Meg brings her into the kitchen to do some work, and this cook takes her back in the room. He's like, "You see anything you like?" And he whips his dick out.
By the way, it was Ronnie. Like, Ronnie brings her back there.
Yeah, not the white guy. He whips it out, and she's just kind of like, Ricky comes in. He's like, "What the fuck are you doing?" He's like, "You didn't see nothing." And they run out, and he's like, and he walks out. He zips his pants up, and the head of the camp's like, "What'd you do? What happened?" He's like, "I guess I must have scared him." And he's like, puts a cigar in his mouth, and he's like,
"I guess you did." And he keeps his eye on him, kind of weird. So he knows something's up there. Mel knows. The guy who runs the camp knows something weird's going on there. But he doesn't do anything about it at that time.
Yeah. But the what happens, though, is this guy who pulled his wiener out on Angela, he's like boiling the water, and he's like, gets some salt. He's like, "Oh, is the water boiling?" Gets on a stool, and the person, like, pushes him to put him in the boiling water, and he's like, "Hey, please give me a hand here, kid.
Hey, knock it off, you little shit. You could have burned me."
I guess he doesn't see the kid at all, because the kid, like, pulls the chair off, and he pulls down the boiling water, and all of a sudden, he's got boiling water all over him, and, you know, the effects look pretty good here. He's screaming, and that's when Robert Earl Jones comes in, and he's like, "Gasp.
What happened to you?"
He goes, "Oh," and it does a close up on his face to show his shock. Like, ding.
Did you notice that as they kept cutting away and cutting back, the boils and the melted flesh got worse? So you could see it actually like setting in, right? The boiling water setting in deep into his skin. Some of the pus pockets, and like you were saying, this is actually one of the better effects, I think, in the film. It kind of grows, like the pus pockets grow, and like the gore is really well done.
It's a little,
in my opinion.
It's really hot water, and like the boils he gets from it. So like, it doesn't kill him, I don't think. He just gets taken to the hospital.
He's blinded. That we are pretty sure of, based on what the doctor's response.
Anyhow, the guy, like, they have a talk with the guy, head of the camp, and he's like, "Oh, let's bury this under the, I don't want to spend too much time on this," but he essentially tells them, "Hey, this never happened," and he gives them all pay raises, kind of sweeten the deal, make sure they don't talk.
Yep, so he gives Artie, he gives Ben the raise, or the promotion, so now he's head chef.
Yeah.
And the boys, the other guys working with Ben, he assures Mel that they won't talk, they won't say anything, and that Artie found a better job. My next notes after that are at the baseball game. Do you have anything before the baseball game?
No.
Perfect. So we'll just move along to that then. And here's where my favorite quote of the movie comes from. All right, Clark?
All right.
"No problem, Gino. This guy blows dead dogs." "Eat shit and die, Ricky. Eat shit and live." All right, so that is my absolute favorite exchange between Ricky and anyone in this film. Fun fact, trivia fact, Ricky got the job for playing Ricky. So the what's the actor's name? Let's see. Jonathan Tiersten got the job. The producer actually asked him, they said, "Okay, I just want you to curse at me. Just throw anything you can come up with. Just curse at me. And so Jonathan just went off on the director slash producer or whatever and got the job instantly. So when you watch this movie, you'll understand why. This kid has the worst mouth of anyone I've ever seen in any film. And hands down, I thought Paul, like, initially I'm like, oh yeah, I love Paul. I remember Paul. I think Ricky outdoes him here in the film. Yeah. And I really loved the baseball game. That whole scene was kind of fun. It definitely makes you feel like you're at camp. It definitely pulls you into that feel.
Right. I feel like we're missing one of the most important characters, Mozart. Who gets picked on the entire film. He's like that kid that you just pick on.
Yeah.
You love him, but you pick on him. And he catches and gets an out, man. He's a hero of the game, but they still shit on him.
And what was he doing? He was playing his old school boxing handheld?
He's playing one of those black and white, one of those ink-based handheld games, like mm-hmm. a boxing game. And then he just catches the ball. Like, that takes some skill. So Mozart, wonderful. Good job. You deserve the win.
Dude, I think the actual quote, even during that scene, they say something along the lines like, man, I can't believe he caught that ball.
Can you believe that?
Can you believe that? And then the next one.
Yeah. 8-6.
Okay, so that clearly, that conversation between Paul and Ricky is just to help everyone understand what the score is. That's all that it's there for. Oh, man. Great job, producer.
They won because of Mozart.
That's the truth. Okay, so a little bit after that. You know, Angela's sitting out again. She doesn't like to participate in anything. And Paul actually decides he's going to go talk with her. He wants to get to know her better, whatever it might be. And he's just talking to her. She's not saying anything. She's not even really looking at him. She's kind of just looking down at the ground, nervously and shy, like she always does. And he says, well, you know, I'm going to head to bed. Good night, Angela. And she responds. These are her first words in the film. We're like, what, more than halfway?
And she smiles. She shows
dude, that
a
was,
smile
that was
on her
too
face.
Good. Stop mimicking characters from movies. You're creeping me out.
I can't help it.
Yeah, he just says goodnight. And then she
and
smiles.
He's like, oh, boy. And he's super happy about it. And he's got like a little, he's sporting a little chubby because he finally got a girl to talk to him. And, you know, he's happy. He's a happy boy.
What's next?
Is this the first kill after this scene? Because the guys go skinny dipping.
Yes, this is the first.
First actual death. And I don't know if this kid picked on her or not, but he was goofing on one of the girls, and he takes her on a canoe, and he flips it. She swims back, and he's just under the canoe, and he's like, "Where are you?"
Oh my God! Hey, Baba Reba!
And then he gets pulled underwater. And the next day, they find his body. And I want to talk about this specifically, because they show what looks to be, it's either a poster or it's canvas, and it's an image. And they show like a snake come through his mouth, and it just looks like the snake comes out of some sort of image. These are old special effects, like it didn't come out of like an actual mouth. I'm pretty sure it was either something printed on canvas or it was, like I said, just like a portrait or a painting.
Yeah.
Some really well done image.
It's, I don't know. It looked, to me, it looked pretty gruesome. Pretty, you know, it looked like a body that had been sitting in water probably overnight for a while.
It did, but the snake on top of it,
that's what,
was definitely
that's what throws
filmed
it off,
on know? Top of, on an image. So yeah.
That's where it loses it. That right there, my friends, that's where it loses it. So a couple of quotes that I love throughout this scene, this area. So the guy who dies is Kenny, and he was picking on her. If you remember, the leader of that boy pack was telling him, well, I don't want to take, you know, my best friend's bright idea away. So they basically asked her if she wanted to, you know, hang out with them or whatever. Trying to get her to go skinny dipping probably later is their whole goal. And he's like, Angela, why are you so fucked up? Like, they just kept, you know, badgering her. And that's when Paul came up and had that whole conversation was right after that. Because the boys got into the fight, Ricky got taken to the infirmary for a bloody nose, and all that jazz. Right. Wait, did the ass prank happen yet? I think that's coming up, right? Mind over matter. All right. Well,
when they're doing that to Mozart, and they put the whipped cream on his face, and he like ends on someone's butt. I think that happened before.
I think so.
That happens before he catches the ball.
Yes, because then he kind of redeems himself, if I remember right. Because I was like, oh, well, Mozart, the dummy. And then Mozart catches that catch. I'm like, hey, he's not so dumb after all. Well, he pulled a knife on Ricky, if you remember. It was kind of a hunter's knife. It's like a nice wooden handle, big blade. And the cabin guy takes it away. There's importance to that, knife. So the counselor took the knife away. That knife makes appearances later on in the film, and that's why I want to bring it up. Just kind
of, I didn't even notice that it was that knife.
Yeah. So that's, I want the listeners to kind of have that feeling of like, there's that knife got taken away from Mozart. So who's got the knife?
Like, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill you. I'm going to stab you in the face. Oh. And he doesn't even like rush to stab him. He's just kind of like slowly waddling towards him to stab him. He's like, oh, he's just playing. We'll see about that. And he puts it underneath like his clothes. Like, he could have definitely gotten his knife back at any point in the film.
Pretty much. I think so.
But I just did a review of that, the Kenny's dead body.
Uh-huh.
And they used a life cast, it looks like.
Huh. Okay. I'll have to look into that more and see what that is, how it's done. And very interesting. So the boys, the friends of Kenny, who's under the boat getting drowned, there's, one of the guys makes a really bad joke. He's like, is this why it's called getting caught with your pants down? Cause they're worried about getting caught by the counselors, and they head out and they forget about him. So they find the body the next day, and Ronnie, is talking with the cop, and he goes, I remember that boy being a pretty good swimmer. And the cop's reply was something along the lines of like, well, I hope it's not true or whatever. Like, basically, he's like, either the kid drowned or he was killed. And I hope he wasn't killed, because for you guys, that could be really bad.
Well, that...
Go ahead.
I mean, the head of the camp's like, oh, no, this was an accident. This was an accident, because he doesn't want to lose money.
Exactly. Mel doesn't want the camp to get shut down, right? He's really over that. So, yeah, the day goes on. Everyone's, you know, doing normal kind of kid campy stuff. And then
go to the rec room to watch a movie.
Yep. Is that's before the water balloons? I think there's some gaps here where I just enjoyed watching the movie.
That. Okay. That was when, so Paul came by to sit next to her, and she's like, hey, how are you? Do you want to go to a movie with me? And then he kisses her, which she's like, no, I don't want to do this, because he's starting to take off her shirt, and she's like, I don't want this. And she's like, no, walks away.
Yep.
And he's like, oh, man, what a prude. So then she gets hit with the water balloon.
Then Ricky loses it.
Yeah, Ricky gets mad, and he's like, I'm going to kill him, whoever threw the water balloon at her.
Yep. And then
Billy, the guy who he's like, eat shit and live.
Yep.
Like, he's sitting in the bathroom. He goes to the bathroom. He's like, I got to take a wicked dump.
He's got to take a dump before he goes and hangs out with the boys.
Well, it's important that it's a wicked dump, because he has to purge himself of Satan. So you see the knife. I guess it's that knife.
Mm-hmm.
Cut the screen, and you see a stick and a beehive get shaken inside there. And this is where the first death that is just seen as, somebody was killed, happens. Billy gets stung to death with bees just all over his face.
Yeah, and that's when, pretty gnarly.
Yeah.
I mean, I think you see, so he's got like these pockets that look like beehive holes, right?
Right.
Already in his skin.
Yeah. Yeah. It's something that you would never actually see if somebody died of bee stings. So
I don't think you would, unless that body was left there a really long time.
Yeah. And honestly, those bees would be dead too.
For the stings.
Unless you are allergic, I don't see him being killed by bees. But when Mel, the head of the camp, finds out that Billy's dead, he's like, I saw evil in this kid's eyes. I know who the killer is. I know who it is. And he goes on like some crazy montage. And he's like, this kid's trying to ruin my life. I know who he is. I'm just like, kind of disconnects us from the film a little bit.
Yeah, there's this like weird pent up aggression that Mel has for no apparent reason. Like he has no, honestly, he has no reason to think that it's Ricky, because that's who he thinks it is. That
he doesn't even say it's Ricky at this point. Like we don't know he's talking about Ricky as the audience.
That's right.
Until like,
there's no obvious reason, right?
Well, Paul apologizes to Angela here, because they're, I think they're at the beach or something, and. That was when Paul, like, this is when Paul tries to make out with Angela. He gave her two kisses before, and she's but, like, eh, yeah. I gotta go.
And but this she is has where he a flashback. Her shirt off.
Yes. And her and her twin brother, they witness their dad in bed with a character named Lenny.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when she's like, okay, looks like Paul's about to get wet and wild with her, and she's like, yeah, get off me. And she just leaves.
So, and we're... And like, they don't ever make it clear. Like, the family tree here is very awkward. Like, we have no idea exactly how it breaks down. You kind of have an idea of who is who a little bit here. But, I mean, the dad is... So the kids walk in on the dad with his boyfriend or husband. You don't really know whether they're married or not. The film's depicted in 83. So you don't really...
You know his name's Lenny?
Yep.
But that's all you know.
That's all you know. And... The kids are kind of giggling and laughing while they're watching this happen. And then they go back to their room and they kind of have this weird moment where they're looking at each other, eye to eye, sitting in their bed.
Pointing directly at Angela.
Yes.
So I think that's...
Is it like, what? I don't know what they're trying to portray there. Honestly,
I think it's some sort of imagery that once you know what's going on in the film, you're like, oh, that makes sense.
Gotcha. Yeah. So just to kind of help bring the viewers in here is why Angela freaks out and pushes Paul away. She's like, no, I can't do this. And then runs off.
And this is where Paul afterwards, you know, he's sexually frustrated and Judy starts kissing him.
That was the next day. Yeah. Yeah. At, they're playing Capture the Flag.
Yeah.
And yeah, Angela catches Paul kissing, you know, the camp slut Judy.
Yeah.
Ricky calls her a scumbag.
And then he sees it.
Yep.
And he's not the only one that sees it, though.
No. Angela's right there.
And Judy, like, smiles. And then Paul's like, and she's like, oh, don't feel so bad, Angela. You should have heard the things he was saying about you. He said you were such a prude. And Paul's like, oh, golly, gee whiz. I sure messed up.
That wood scene, though, so Judy looks really sad. So, like, her and Ricky have that exchange. You're a scumbag, Judy, you know that? And then she says something witty back to him. He says something witty back to her and flips her off as he walks away back out of the woods. And she sits there, and the camera just sits on her face. And it's there for, like, a good 15, 20 seconds, and she looks so disappointed and sad. Like, this is a girl who clearly has issues. And anyways, I feel like this whole movie, Judy's just begging for attention. This whole film.
Yeah.
But yeah, anyways, this isn't about Judy. This movie is not about Judy. Yeah. Holy fuck, bees!
Okay, so it goes, I don't remember. So like Paul tries to apologize to Angela after this. He's like, I'm sorry for calling you a prude. And Angela just doesn't hear it.
Meet me at the beach.
Yeah. So... Anyhow, after that, so Paul tries to talk to Angela. I think it's in the rec room. And then Judy comes in, and then she kind of is like, aren't they such a nice couple? Or maybe that's not it, but...
No, that's it. That's it. They were on the staircase, and Paul's trying to like get her back. He's trying to win her back, right? And
Judy comes out. At the waterfront by the pier, Meg and Judy try to pick her up and throw her in the water.
Oh, that is right before that.
And this is the point where Mel's like grabs Rick, and he's like, I know you killed him. And like he's seeing... Angela about to be thrown in the water.
You always run to her side anytime she's in trouble. Well, not this time, you little fucker.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mel loses it on Ricky. This is where you officially know, like, Mel is Mel thinks it's Ricky, 100%.
You're trying to get back at me because of what I did to you. And I'm just like, I question what he did to him. It's like, is it because he didn't let him go to the canteen?
For a week? Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the only assumption I can make, yeah.
It's like, yeah, no, he's not going to kill people for that reason. But,
no.
Okay.
No. There's way more reasoning behind who he's killing and why he's killing them, for sure.
Right.
So then, you're right, that happens. Then later on, Paul and her on the steps, they're going through that whole sequence. He's trying to win her back, apologizing. You know, I didn't mean those things I said. He's definitely backtracking here and trying to get her back. And then Judy comes out with her new boyfriend. It's the blonde guy. And then says, "Don't they make a cute couple?" And snarkily laugh, walk off.
Yeah.
And then that's when Angela tells Paul, "Meet me at the, you know, beachfront or whatever at 9 o'clock, right? Something like that.
Yeah. Right.
And she has that. Okay, so she does it, but she's not looking at him. She's looking away, looking off camera. Yeah.
She's got like kind of a creepy smile.
Yeah. Yeah. This is the first glimpse that where you see Angela doesn't, I mean, she doesn't look so normal. Like something weird is going on there. I don't know if it's seduction she's trying to pull off or creepiness, but I'm kind of weirded out at this point.
So if you were watching this for the first time, your thought process would be, well, it looks like Angela's the killer the whole movie. And which you don't know, like my thought process was, well, maybe they're not going to make her the killer. But before then, you see like six kids throw sand at Angela after she gets out of the water when the lifeguard and Ricky pull her out.
Uh-huh.
And these six kids go out camping. And during all this, like the counselor takes two of them back. And when he comes back, he sees a bunch of sleeping bags just hacked to bits.
Yeah, I got a note. Like
he was done with Eddie's axe.
Yep. I got a note here that says, all the kills had been revenge until all the little kids. And then
kids that threw sand.
Yeah. Now that I'm hearing you say it, I'm like, oh, never mind. Cross that off my notes. What an idiot. It was revenge. It was revenge.
So meanwhile, like I have a theory that, and this is never proven or disproven through the film. I guess it might be in the sequel. I haven't seen it, but I have a theory that there are two killers. Because this Woods, like he takes them to his car and he drives them back. And during this whole while this kill is being happened, Ricky is in his bed lying down, or that's his excuse.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't see where he or Angela are, but you do see Judy whoever it is,
Meg.
This girl's not Meg. Is it Meg?
Who takes a whoever shower?
Has a crush. It's Meg who has a crush on Mel.
Yep.
Oh, okay. Anyhow, she has a date with Mel, the old creepy owner of the establishment.
This is probably one of the scenes, probably the most uncomfortable scene for me in this movie, when this young, maybe 17, 18-year-old Meg, I'm not sure what age she's trying to portray, but she's a camp counselor, so you figure she's older than most of them, basically asks Mel out on a date. Hey, remember that dinner you said you were going to make me?
What about 9 o'clock, 9:30?
Everything's happening at 9, by the way, just in this movie. Everything important happens at 9 o'clock.
So she's in the shower and a knife comes through the wall and stabs her, which, you know, sure, why not? But she's dead now and those kids are dead. And these bodies are too far apart for it to happen in such a short period of time. So my assumption is there's got to be two killers. Unless this is just something they missed.
Let me throw you even something better. There's a third kill.
There is.
It's all in that same window. Like this, the way they're cutting these scenes up, I agree with you. It feels like there's more than one killer. And I'm not saying there's three. Two at max. No way this movie is smart enough to even think that there were three. Two at max.
They show you the silhouette and they show kind of the face of one of the people that they're like, it seems like it's misdirection in the film, but Judy, she's in the room with Mike, who she's making out with, this blonde guy.
Mm-hmm.
And Mel comes in, he's like, hey, have you seen Meg? And she's like, ah, she took a shower. So Mel leaves, And she's like, "You." And the guy's like, "I'm leaving because he might come back." And she's like, "You're such a little bitch."
Basically.
And Mel discovers Meg's body. He cries. He goes, "Not you, not you." And you see Ricky's silhouette through the door.
Definitely.
And Judy gets killed here. But.
So trivia fact, the reason why it's Ricky, and this is, they've stated it, like the film producers and whatnot, they've stated it. Basically, Angela, the lady who plays Angela, Felissa Rose, was not old enough to do the shots for all the kills in the movie. She wasn't old enough to film it. So they had to use somebody else, and they figured, why not use the person who looks most similar to her slash him, because they wanted that confusion, I think. But they definitely used Ricky for all of the kill scenes. So anytime you see a hand or the silhouette, it is 100% Ricky, which I thought was a really interesting take on it, especially with Clark, how you're describing the time between kills, the fact that we definitely see Ricky's silhouette here. You know, and then I think back to the knife. I think back to how did that knife, because here it gets used again in the pools or in the shower scene. So it's been used twice for sure. Yeah, it's just really interesting how they film this, because especially because of the way it ends, because of when you do get that payoff moment, when you find out who the killer really is.
Well, Mel finds Ricky. I'm going to skip a couple. Stuff just to hurry through.
Yeah.
Since we're kind of taking a while.
But, you can't skip the curling iron kill.
Yeah.
You want to, but you can't.
That's right. So that is how Julie dies, is because he shoves a pillow, the murderer, which is Ricky's silhouette. He puts a pillow on her face, and he forces a curling iron somewhere, which, you know, the assumption is it goes in her vagina.
I mean, we don't know. That's up to the viewer.
That's for you to decide, but they're definitely jamming it somewhere.
And she dies from it.
That's how she dies. Yep. And Mel finds Ricky after this.
Mm-hmm. Because he's hell-bent.
Everybody's like, where is everyone?
I can't believe he did this to Meg. That's what he keeps saying. He is 100% sure it's Ricky.
He beats the shit out of Ricky, and Ricky is just... It doesn't show, like, Ricky's body until after. And you see, like, he's just like, oh, no, what have I done? What have I done? And then he runs into the archery range, and he's like, it can't be you. Not you. And he gets shot in the neck.
Arrow to the throat.
So, yeah.
I thought that was pretty good.
So that's when the police get called.
Yep. And the final payoff happens. There you go. That's it. That's the end of Sleepaway Camp.
Yep.
Man, I still want to, like... I really wish we could talk about the end here, but we can't. We just can't.
I do want to say one thing.
Mm-hmm.
They did... whoever you think the killer is, you're right. It's very obvious who the killer is in this movie. It's not... There's no subterfuge there, but the ending is definitely worth seeing.
Yeah.
And, beyond that,
I can't believe how much we talked about this movie, honestly. I thought we'd be able to get through both movies by this time.
I feel like maybe we put a little bit more time on the synopsis, which, you know, we could cut that out later on down the road. But
yeah.
What are your final thoughts on this film? Like, since you've seen it several times, like, what brings you to this movie? Like, why do you love it so much?
I love it for the rewatchability, knowing what's happening, who's doing it, and then trying to pick out, like, I don't know, what you just did to my mind right now just blew it. Like, I'm going to have to watch this movie again now, because I want to see if there's any other areas where, now that I know who they used for filming the killing, if you watch and you pay attention to all of the A happened, so B happened, right? This person kicked sand at her or whatever, so... You know, these kids died. It's like, but who is sticking up for Angela? Angela is so quiet, so meek, so shy, so little. The number, you know, serial killers, the whole, you know, the research behind it is that women are less likely to be serial killers. Men are more likely to be killers, blah, blah, blah. Like, they're definitely feeding into all of that throughout this entire movie. And so for me personally, I like to rewatch this movie because I love to look for those different aspects and try to find slip ups or moments where it's like, oh, I should have picked up on that, you know, different right. things like that. I give it a high rating. I give it a very high rating. This is like an 8 out of 10 for me. I love this movie.
I give it a 6 out of 10 for this being my first time. I don't have the same love for it that you do. It was interesting. I kind of laughed at the ending. I thought it looked really goofy. but if you watch this movie for the first time, and you'll know what I'm talking about, or if you've seen this movie, you'll know. It's just, it's kind of goofy.
Yep. But definitely goofy.
That's Sleepaway Camp.
But that's going to be Sleepaway Camp. Yep.
Okay, so the second film we're going to talk about this week is Slumber Party Massacre 2 from 1987. It's got a 38% on Rotten Tomato, and it runs for about 77 minutes long. Quick synopsis, just so everyone knows what it's about. A teen and her friends are terrorized by a rock star whose guitar is fitted with a drill bit. Once again, these were my picks, so I made Clark watch these and made him suffer, I hope.
I did suffer, but not in the way that you had hoped.
Okay.
I'm looking for my... I found it. But yeah, it was... There were... Summer Party Massacre, it's a bad movie, but it felt like they didn't want it to be a bad movie. They were trying to make a scary movie, but I don't know who this movie was made for.
Okay. That's fair. Because, I mean, I had... My very first note is, what chick flick is this? Because the very intro of the movie is like very slow and soft, and it feels like just like a chick flick. Like, girls would love this movie.
But then you get into the scantily clad dance scenes, and like the very first beginning is like, was this movie made for teenage boys, or was it made for teenage girls? Because you're not catering to either one of them.
Yeah, I was like, oh, never mind, here we go. This is where you're drawing me in now, and this is where I can actually get behind the film.
Right.
So we open with her having a nightmare about the killings. So if you haven't seen Slumber Party Massacre, just a quick tie-in so you understand, is this is the younger sister of the gal who was terrorized in the first film. The killer from the first film and the killer from the second film, there's really no like connection there. In the first film, it's just some guy in a van, like a work van. And he terrorizes this girl and her friends at a slumber party. He's addicted. Like, he's just drawn to them for whatever reason.
I haven't seen the first film. I was told that I don't need any context. All I know is nope. that this was Nightmare meets Elm Street
here,
meets Elvis.
So you're nailing it. Yeah, this is, I mean, we can get into some other Elvis films later if we want to. That I think could be pretty bad to watch. But yeah, so she wakes up. You know, she's had her nightmare. She's talking to her mom, and her mom's telling her about, you know, oh, your sister this, and she's doing good in the psych ward, and blah, blah, blah. You remember all that?
Yeah, I actually had some sort of disconnect. At the very beginning, I was like, okay, so someone went crazy, and then you have, like, a very happy family breakfast at the very beginning, and, I don't know, her birthday is coming up, and...
And she doesn't want to go visit her sister on her birthday.
Yeah.
Because it's her birthday.
Yeah.
And who wants to go visit their crazy sister on their birthday?
Right. And then she has like nightmares of like, don't go. And visions of her sister dying as soon as she gets in the car. And her friends are like, you okay? And she's like, yeah, let's go. We got a party. Woo.
Yep. And instantly she just puts it all behind her, tries to push those memories or those dreams out, and wants to just go have fun with her friends.
Right.
You're passing the dead bird that she sees, though.
Yeah, I passed a whole lot of stuff.
Which is our first fun fact, though. It's a trivia piece. So that dead bird that you use actually was a real dead bird that was frozen for the film. And I remember you texting me that night. You were like, oh, man, that dead bird, though? And I was like, fun fact, it was a real dead bird, and it looked real.
They put ketchup on it. That was ketchup on it. They froze a dead bird, and then they put ketchup on it and put it right in front of someone.
Can you say ketchup one more time?
Ketchup.
I was just curious.
Yeah, I can say ketchup if you want, or catsup, whatever you prefer, but...
All right.
Not all of us are from Arizona.
I sometimes I don't sound like I'm from Arizona.
You're good.
So, chick rock group practice. What'd you think of that?
Obviously, this was dubbed over. Obviously, they weren't really singing it. The The girls were just trying to rock out, you know. It's not something you would hear at a garage, ever.
I don't think so, no.
No.
I think it's a little higher level than that.
Yeah.
I don't think they're at the point that, I mean, they are, so they're practicing for that big show or whatever. It's like a, you know, battle of the bands or whatever kind of thing. Right. And they're kind of preparing for it. I think they're a little bit better than your average garage band.
I wouldn't even say better. I would just say the sound is off. It sounds too professional grade. It sounds like something you would hear on a musical album as opposed to like something you'd hear at a garage. So it's always jarring whenever you hear music that's just dubbed over and you can tell it's not them singing. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So they keep rocking out. And then the boys show up, two of the boys.
Right.
So they're rocking out, they're having fun, then they chill out, they start pigging out, right?
Right.
They're having like a picnic in this living room.
Oh, right before then, they're all dancing with their shirts off. Like, don't forget about that.
Yeah.
You get to see your first, free gratuitous boobs. Actually, I think it's the only gratuitous.
It's the only gratuitous nude scene. And it's just one chick.
I actually feel like this girl acted it out very well. Not just like girls dancing around having fun, and then she's like about to put her bra back on. She's like, "Yeah, put those away," and she's like, "Boxed like a chicken."
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, you know what? I could see someone in real life doing that.
Yeah, I agree. Another fun fact: so one of the main female, I believe, in the movie, it's either the main female or the best friend. It was actually a porn star, and she did Slumber Party Massacre 2 because she wanted to get away from porn. This was her trying to break out into acting. So she did no nudity in this film and had a no nudity clause. It was the long blonde haired one with the big boobs that never shows her boobs. And unfortunately, after this film, she actually went right back to porn because it didn't pay off. So another piece of trivia there for you, like the one girl trying to get out of porn does this film and it doesn't pay off the way she was hoping.
She
kind of sad.
Yeah, none of these people could act.
No. And we'll get to the awards later on because my favorite character has not entered the film just yet.
Yeah.
But after the gratuitous boobs and girls throwing champagne, I mean everywhere. This living room was covered in champagne. The girl was like just spraying it and drinking it and spitting it. Like
a waste of money.
Such a waste of money.
And the floor. Oh man, your dad's gonna be mad at you. That carpet
would have been trashed. But yeah, so they have fun and the two boys show up. So here enters my favorite guy in the film. It's the total, he's like high as a kite. Yeah, man, let's hang out with the girls. Don't worry. It's that guy. He is so overacting his part. And you know what? The best part is I don't know who he is actor-wise. I didn't look him up or anything. I don't know what other films he's done, but I have a feeling like that could be him in real life. That just might be the way he is.
He was such a burnout, but he acted like a jock. The character didn't work.
Oh my God. They rip apart the pillows. I'm just looking here. Like this is ridiculous.
Right, this is your basic slumber party fight scene, and then the kids break in and they try to scare the girl and like, oh my gosh, I thought you were a killer. Try to lead into this. But there are some visions before this weird party happens that show the Elvis Presley boogeyman. So
yeah, I mean there's a lot of visions telling her not to go, you know, not to have sex, not to party, not to whatever. Like, there's a lot of this driving home, you know, drugs are bad, sex is bad, alcohol's bad, you know, like...
This movie's about abstinence.
It's a lot of abstinence on a lot of things. But yeah, so the guys, they sneak into the kitchen.
Right.
And one of them pretends to be dead.
Right.
And that's my favorite guy, I believe. And then the other guy's being a total tool with him. And then, like, they get up, and I just remember writing this quote because I thought it was really funny at the time, but he goes... One of them goes, smoke. And the other one goes, And then they go, smoke them. I don't know why they thought that was funny back then, but it wasn't. And it's really not funny now. And I feel bad just saying
it. Is that just to signify, hey, these guys are high? This entire movie.
Yep. We get more dreams. The girls go to bed. We get a bunch more dreams. And then we start to find out their names. So if you listen to a lot of the names of the characters, one girl's name is Trish Craven. The officers in the film, they also have fun names for you. One of them, I believe, is Kruger, Officer Kruger.
Right.
These are all just kind of hat tips or hat nods to some of the more famous horror films that have come out recently. The Voorhees, I believe, is another family in the movie. The Cravens, and then you have Dr. Kruger, or Officer Kruger, and then is it Officer Kruger and Officer Voorhees, I think? Those are the two main ones, but I can't remember 100%.
I don't remember the other doctor. It's like Kroger or Kruger. You are correct.
Yeah. It was very funny.
Right. Was it during the party scene, or is it the next day? One of the girls like sees blood in the bathtub or something?
That's the next day, yeah.
Yeah.
So they wake up the next day. They all have hangovers. They're totally messed up from that champagne party they had, right?
Right.
So they decide, what are we going to do? We're going to put on, you know, bikinis, and we're going to go out in the bright sun, because that'll help our migraines, right? Mm-hmm. I would never do that. I don't think anyone realistically would want to do that. But then my favorite character jumps in with the sex doll and cannonballs into the pool with it and uses it as a floaty.
It's her brother's sex doll.
It's Trish's brother's sex doll, whatever. It's great.
We never meet the brother. We just hear about him.
And I think he was a stand-up guy. He was going to his parents' condo or whatever to just have a night alone with his sex doll. What's wrong with that?
Look, man, I don't judge anyone.
Can't judge. So they're out there. They're having fun, playing in the pool, whatever. They haven't grilled their food just yet, right? No, because she goes inside to rest. That's when the pimple queen happens.
Oh shit, yeah. So what's her face, the lead singer of their band, the blonde, she goes up and she's like, so like water's overflowing, and she's like, oh no, I need your help, because vision stuff's already happened, people think she's crazy.
Yep.
And she's like, come upstairs, and then she's like, oh, the bathroom's flooding. And then to kind of make her friend feel a little bit better, she's like, oh, don't worry about it. Look at this pimple. She's like, I don't see anything. She's like, oh, it's like a hidden pimple. I need to get more acne clear. And then, like, well, the girl's looking at her. Every time the camera backs away and then goes back on her, like, the zit's getting bigger.
It just gets bigger.
Until it's, like, overtaken her face. And then it just, like, explodes all over her. And then she's like, she's dead. She's dead. Her head exploded. Which we don't see. We just see the zit pop.
Yeah. We just see the zit bust open all over, and like this nasty like
green
goop just hits her in the face. And so that the pop happens, like the pimple pop happens, and it cuts to the girl getting hit in the face with all of it.
Yeah.
And then she runs downstairs.
Yep.
So to your point, we never see a head explode. We don't know at all what happened.
We just see a little bit of it.
We just see a little bit. Come on, man. It was like,
it's a tiny amount, man. It's pretty standard. You don't have that much when you pop a zit?
No!
It's pretty normal.
No! So anyway, she runs downstairs, grabs everyone, she runs back upstairs, and the girl's gone.
Yeah.
She's missing. They don't know where their friend went. And so they spend the rest of that afternoon basically freaking out, stressing out, and that's when they call the cops. That's basically when the cops show up.
Right. They hear the bone grinder or the trash disposal, and they're like, all right, we're going to find that body in there. And then the friend comes back.
Yep.
She's like, yeah, I met a rad guy at this grocery store, and we just hit it off, and I got some acne medication for this zit.
Oh, man.
Cops are like,
we are definitely mashing some stuff together, but I'm okay with that, because that's exactly how this movie feels. So some of the things we missed out on. We got another chick band practice montage where the boys are in the, like, sitting down watching them, right?
And they're rocking out.
You've got the pimple queen initially, where she's just complaining about the pimple. Then they go outside and they grill, and that's right. When she gets the hamburger. So there's the freaking hamburger with the fake hand in it. It's another one of those visions she's having. And she freaks out, and then they're like, well, here's a chicken one. That one will be fine. And then she eats the chicken one, right?
Right.
Then she basically goes into the kitchen to get some water, goes to open the fridge, and a chicken, like a death chicken, jumps out at her and wants to kill her. Another hallucination or whatnot. And then, oh man, then she goes upstairs to have the bath scene. She's in the bathtub, and it fills up with blood. So she runs to get her pimple friend. Pimple friend comes up, and she's like, what are you doing leaving the tub on? Well, the tub wasn't on in her mind, right? Then the pimple explodes. Friend goes missing. I have birthday cake written down. What the hell do I have birthday cake written down for? Did they celebrate a birthday?
There must have been something to do with the birthday cake or some sort of vision. I don't remember.
Yeah.
All that I know is that the police show up and they're like, you kids, yes. I hate how rich you are. I'm not going to write you up because I hate your lawyers and I don't like lawyers at all. And when I was your age, my father took me back to the shed. That's a different movie, but...
And then the dad stood up and he started to take off his belt and he's like, oh wait, he didn't take it off. He just tightened it and he goes,
Daddy, what are you going to do?
What are you going to do?
Tightening my belt so I don't feel
hunger pains. So anyways, this is where the movie actually gets good to me personally. Yeah. So this entire hour and 10 minutes of buildup or whatever in this very short film is boring. It's drawn out. It's terrible acting. And it just completely ruins the film for me, because now we get a chance to actually see the Driller Killer, and the Driller Killer comes to life. So he's no longer a vision. He's real, and he is ready to kick some ass.
Before that, her boyfriend actually shows up.
Oh, yeah.
He goes upstairs, and like they're about to consummate, and then during that, like she sees her boyfriend die, and that the whole scene there is jarring. It doesn't make any sense to me, because you see the drill come through the boyfriend's chest, and like the Driller Killer's got to be behind him, right? No, he's right by the door, and then he picks up the boyfriend's leg, and it's been dismembered, and it's like, how did
all of that happen? It's one of those things where it's like, you don't really know still what she's seeing is real or what she's seeing is fake. But the minute he picks up the leg, you know now he's there. Like, it's finally real. Now, how he got dismembered that fast, I have no idea. Maybe she was, like, kind of out of it and in, like, a vision, and he was just chopping this dude up. I don't know.
I got a theory later on.
But... Okay, perfect. We'll get to it. Let's run through the kills real quick if we remember all of them.
Let's do that. But before then, so like I didn't know the Driller Killer was real until they went downstairs, and I was like, okay, so are the friends gonna see it or what?
Yeah.
And then she's like, "There's a killer," and I'm like, oh, this dumb person.
I've seen this movie a few times, so yeah, that's lost for me. Like, I know he's coming, and I anticipate it. I can't wait for him to show up, because like I said, that's when the party really begins. But yeah, so like they all run downstairs. Mm-hmm. Sheila goes to call the cops again.
Yes.
And they're basically telling her, like, you stupid kids. Like, we're not coming up there. We've already fallen for your tricks once. So they don't come. And then...
the blonde gets drilled by the guitar drill right through the phone.
Through the phone, which it's clean all the way through.
Through the wall. This is on the other side of the wall, folks. Not in the phone.
Right.
On the other side of the wall.
So through her... through the wall, through the phone, through everything, no blood. But then when he pulls it back out, then there's blood all over the drill.
Yep.
Little crazy. Madness ensues.
This movie's not believable.
No. And if that's where you lost your suspension of disbelief, then I'm sorry, because you took fell
this,
for it.
I took this as a joke the entire time the killer showed up, because he's singing, he's dancing, he's...
Oh my God.
He's that acting dance like
sequence
Elvis.
Is so good.
He starts singing half the time, and he's like, baby, I want your love. It's like they kind of made this movie to make a record.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so it came out in the 80s, right? Everything in the 80s was rock and roll, drug, sex. You know, even most of your other horror films have that everyone's out to have fun. Like, I mean, Sleepaway Camp, Jason... a lot of those films, they're all just having fun, hanging out together, doing things their parents won't let them do, and horror ensues. It's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
So we get a lot of kills here. A lot of friends get jacked up. But the end of the film, the sequence, the killer's dance sequence as he's chasing her throughout the constructed homes was probably one of my favorite parts of the movie, because... I feel like it was very well shot. It was kind of fun. And at that point, I think they said, screw it. Let's just do something crazy. She's running along, you know, rooftops. He's popping up in and out of everywhere, continuously playing his guitar, singing to her.
Keeps acting like he's in love with her.
Oh, he is in love with her. Totally.
But he was in love with her sister, and he's like, I killed your sister. Now I want to have sex with you and then kill you too.
See, and this is where, like, it bugs me, because in this film... the killer is a completely different person. and make and model, right? He's a rocker. In the first one, that's not really what he was. And I know I told you like there's really no connection between the two, and there still really isn't, other than the fact that it's the sister of the girl from the last film, and there is a guy who is hooked on them. That's really the only similarities between the films. It's very loosely connected, I'd say. But yeah, I mean, all in all, just last 20 minutes is fun.
It's not a bad last 20 minutes. But the one thing, so when I want to note, like when she's up there in the rafters and she's hiding, the killer's like, I don't know where she went, until like some blood dropped down above, and then he's like, oh you.
It's like that whole Troll 2 scene where the kid is hiding in the attic above the preacher, and then, oh yeah, no one ever would have seen him right there except for his skateboard falling. Oh man,
it fell through the other side too.
Yeah.
Anyhow.
Anyways, there's a lot of similarities in horror films, and as we do more of the episodes, we're gonna connect more of those dots, and I think it's gonna be a lot of fun to kind of connect those pieces together. And as you listeners are following along with us, you'll be able to get a good laugh out of that stuff too. But yeah, so the last question I have for you is it all a dream? Was it all a dream?
You know what? My theory is this movie is a hallucination. She's drunk. Or she did some drugs that they don't show us in the show. Because that ending just doesn't make any sense. I get why they did it. They're like, oh, we gotta have a scene where she wakes up and it's all a dream. But no, it's not.
But it is?
But what? It's... She wakes up, and then she die, or she wakes up, nightmare scene, and then she wakes up again, then another nightmare scene. So this movie is basically a corny Nightmare on Elm Street. Personal opinion.
I would agree with you. All right, let's get into the ratings real quick for this, and Sleepaway Camp. We'll just kind of run through both of them. So Sleepaway Camp is still one of my favorite films. Even though I know the twist at the end and whatnot, like, I still love it. Slumber Party Massacre 2, like I said, this movie is only good for the last 20 minutes. So it's kind of one of those, you're at a party, throw it on in the background maybe. Or even just fast forward to the end and just watch that. That's pretty much my opinion on it.
Yeah.
What do you think? What's your rating?
Sleepaway Camp, This was the first time I've seen it, and honestly, I'm not quite certain how I feel about it. I don't know if I like it, I don't know if I dislike it. I do know that it has not aged as well. Just some of the stuff just didn't look very real to me, and I couldn't take it as seriously as you probably should. Slumber Party Massacre 2, I would not watch that movie. Like, if you put it on at a party, I'd be like, all right. And I'd
laugh about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In the background. Last 20 minutes, though, I'd be like, yeah.
I watched this. That's when you'd catch Clark sitting on the couch, just all of a sudden paying attention to the film that no one was paying attention to before. Because he knows what's coming at that moment.
Get the drinks out. It's time for the drinking game. Every time he starts singing, or every time he mentions that how he's in love with the girl, you take a drink. You would not be driving home, but it's okay. It wouldn't be as terrible as taking a drink every single time somebody eats something green in Troll.
Oh, man. We talked about not doing drinking games for certain movies. Do not do that for Troll 2, please.
No.
All right, well, that's Sleepaway Camp and Slumber Party Massacre 2. Thanks for listening, and stay tuned for our next episode coming out.
Thank you.
Just how much fun it, like, I actually enjoy Slumber Party Massacre as a fun party flick. Not so much as like a serious horror, but treating it as like a comedic horror. So like my big feeling throughout this film is just how ridiculous it really is.